Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome back to our chemistry class. So we'll continue with water. My name is Ebuka Hadi. In our last class, we talked about sources of water, rain and other sources of water. And today we'll be looking into water cycle, how all of this water are being cycled into the atmosphere and coming back into the Earth surface. Now, this is the diagram here. You can see a typical diagram of the water cycle around here. The water cycle is also known as hydrological cycle. And this is the evaporation process here. Evaporation, which is one of the major processes in the cycle, is the transfer of water from the surface of the earth to the atmosphere. By evaporation, water from the earth's surface is being transferred into the atmosphere through gaseous or vapor states. This transfer occurs when some molecules in water mass have attained sufficient kinetic energy to reject themselves from the water. Now, if you look at this collection very well, it is until when some water molecules have attained sufficient kinetic energy, they will reject themselves. And why they reject themselves? They reject themselves as gaseous or vapor form, so they can be easily evaporated into the atmosphere. So the transition process from the gaseous or vapor state to the liquid state is called condensation. Now, if you look up here, we see condensation. Why they remove from the water surface, why they remove from the earth surface as gaseous and vapor state through evaporation into the atmosphere? They went up to form liquid state. They went up to change into liquid state through condensation. And condensation may take place as soon as the air contains more water than it can receive from a free water surface through evaporation. Now, by condensation, water vapor in the atmosphere is released to form precipitation, as you can see here. Water vapor here in the atmosphere will be released to form precipitation. Precipitation that falls to the Earth's surface, this is the Earth's surface here, is distributed to the ocean, to the lake, or to the river, where it is being collected again for evaporation. So that is how the water cycle evolves, and that's how it goes on. Yes, many of our sources of water have been contaminated with so many impurities, either from human factor, from nature and other stuff. That is why it is needed for us to treat our water before proper usage in our home and any other place. Here we can see the water treatment process diagram here, how it is being treated before we can use it at home. First, the untreated water is passed through large settling tank where chemicals like potash alum or sodium aluminate 3 are added to cause coagulation and flocculation. We can see the settling tanks here where the raw water is being passed so that it can form coagulation and flocculation after adding potash alum and sodium aluminate 3. So what is coagulation and flocculation? Coagulation is the coming together of all the dirt in the water to form a bigger particle so that they can easily settle at the bottom of the settling tank, so that they can easily be sieved at once. So after that, we come to the treatment where it is being filtered. This filtration box here, this filtration tank here, filters the fine dirt that are not scum up with the flocculation or coagulation process. So the fine ones are being filtered away from here before we can now redirect them to another treated tank, where we can add our chemicals like chlorine to kill the germs, and we can add our calcium oxide to reduce acidity and remove the hardness of water before we can now use it in our various home or anywhere we want to make usage of it. Here we have types of water. We only have two types of water, that is hard water and soft water. And under hard water, we have temporarily hard water and we have permanently hard water. Hard water contains number of dissolved salts, that is calcium tetrahydrosulfate 6 and magnesium tetrahydrosulfate 6. You may affect the effect of hard water in our kitchen when we are washing clothes or when we are washing plates. Literally the last time we wash, depending on the hardness of the water. After using soap to wash either our plate or our soap, we may feel like there was a film of residue left on our hands, like there are some films remaining on our hands after the washing. That means there is presence of hard water, there's hardness in the water we've used. Soap doesn't form leather. These are the characteristics we will see when we are washing our plates. It won't form leather, thereby making it hard for us to wash, making us using more soap to get things clean. it will only react with calcium to form soap scum. So it is just the soap scum we will be seeing. It won't form lead up, so that it will make it easy for us to wash or to get things clean. So that is hard water. So soft water is a surface water that contains low concentration of ions, and in particular is low in calcium and magnesium, unlike hard water that is full of calcium tetrasulfate and magnesium tetrasulfate. Soft water that doesn't contain it has a low calcium and magnesium ion. For example, if you look at rainwater very well, we see that rainwater is actually one of the purest form of water. So rainwater is a typical example of soft water. Now to the temporary hardness and permanent hardness of water. As we said earlier, that two types of hardness of water is temporary and hardness of water. Now temporary hardness of water is caused by the presence of calcium hydrogen trihydrocarbonate 4, which decomposes on methane. Now we can see it through this equation down here, that it can be removed through boiling. So when we boil hydrogen trihydrocarbonate 4, it gives us calcium trihydrocarbonate 4, which precipitates it and removes the calcium ion that is making it a hard water, that is making it hard. When it is being boiled, the calcium ion is being removed, which precipitates it into calcium trihydrocarbonate 4, water and carbon dioxide. So we can remove it through boiling. We can remove temporary hardness of water through boiling. So after boiling, that means it can be used in our various home for anything. So to permanent hardness of water, it is caused by the presence of calcium and magnesium ion in form of soluble tetrasulfate 6 and chloride. That means it is formed because of the presence of calcium tetrasulfate 6 or because of the presence of magnesium tetrasulfate 6. It can be removed by precipitating the calcium and magnesium ion through addition of washing soda, caustic soda, and other chemicals. We can see the equation down here, where we have sodium carbonate plus calcium tetrasulfate 6, which precipitates back into calcium carbonate and sodium tetrasulfate 6 acid. So this precipitation actually removes the calcium ion from the equation, which makes it less hardness. So this same equation still goes for the magnesium ion. When we add washing soda like sodium carbonate to magnesium tetrasulfate 6, it precipitates it into calcium carbonate 2, thereby removing the magnesium ion so that it can make it less hard. Now we forge ahead to properties of water. Water properties actually contain both physical and chemical properties. Now to the physical properties. Pure water is a colorless, odorless, and tasteless liquid with the following property. That means a very clean and pure water is colorless, odorless, and tasteless liquid. The following properties are its physical properties. A boiling point of 100 degrees Celsius, that is the temperature at which liquid becomes gas. 2 is a freezing point of 0 degrees Celsius, that is the temperature at which it becomes solid. Now, the maximum density at around 4 degrees Celsius, that is when water freezes, that means when water freezes, it expands rapidly, adding about 9% of volume or adding more volume to it. When it freezes, it expands, so it adds more volume to itself. Now, it is neutral to litmus, that is, it is neither base nor acidic. It has a neutral pH. Now, it has a specific heat. Specific heat is the amount of energy required to change the temperature of a substance. And water can absorb large amount of heat energy before it begins to hot. It also releases energy when situation causes it to cool. Now let's look at a very hot knife. If you put it inside water, it will take a long time before the water will actually turn hot. Yes, because it has a specific heat limit. It has the amount of heat that could make the water rises, the water temperature to rise. Now to chemical properties. Water reacts with a lot of substances to form different compounds. They are amphoteric in nature. Amphoteric means they can act as both acid and base. They are redox reaction. Electropositive elements reduce water to hydrogen molecule. Thus, water is a great source of hydrogen. For example, let's take during the process of photosynthesis, water is being oxidized into oxygen. So as water can be oxidized and reduced, it is very, very useful and a very useful tool in redox reactions. Now to hydrolysis reaction. Water has a very strong hydrating tendency due to its dielectric constant. It dissolves many ionic compounds. Some covalent and ionic compounds can be hydrolyzed in water. As we all know, water is a very good solvent that can dissolve, like explanation I gave earlier, it can dissolve most compounds, it can dissolve most substances. So that is why it is good for hydrolysis reaction. All of these are its chemical properties, and we still have more on that. So to this assignment, I want us to go through this assignment and give us feedback. We'll see where to submit it. We'll send the mailware to submit it. Thank you very much. And you can further contact us through Jimo Smith, jimo.edufest@gmail.com. Thank you.